discount, we have to fund that discount ourselves. The new scheme that's been agreed for housing associations, which would pick up the other 50% of our tenants, the government and the National Housing Federation, which is our trade body that was negotiating this, the agreement has been that there would be full compensation. How that's going to be funded has been a bit of an issue. The government haven't got that funding in place yet. So at the minute there is a pilot scheme. We think they're going to use some pilot associations in the West Midlands to test how that will work, and then it'll be rolled out again. So we won't see right to buy being extended to us this year, we don't think, but it could come in the next year or the year after that. But going back to your question, the idea that the government's got is that for every property we sell, we would get reimbursed on the basis that we then replace that with a new social rented property from the income that we get from the sale. So that's being tested, as I say, at the moment in the pilots, but we'll have to wait to see how that works out. It's unknown at this stage, but that's the government's intention.
Thank you. Okay, Chris? Cool. That's quite a long and elaborate question. We've answered some of my answers. I can ask, I seem to remember, was it last year or maybe the year before, you gave us a presentation about the change in the structure of the business and looking at alternative business strategy. Has that, could you give us a little bit of an inkling about what's happened there, if it's going to be detrimental to the housing sector, or whether it's going to add to it? And a quick second question, if I may, is what's happening with Clifton Avenue flats in my ward?
Okay. Right. I'll pick both of those up. Clearly public resources are under pressure. We're in austerity, Britain, and in past years, housing associations could bid to the housing corporation, as was the Homes and Community Agency, as it's now called, for grants to build affordable homes for rent. Clearly that budget's been under some pressure and has been reduced, and therefore we and other organisations similar to us have been forced to look at other ways of raising funding to put into making social housing affordable, because it's only affordable because it has a subsidy. Now, there's no government subsidy, so we are looking at doing other activities. So we've set up two other companies. We are a registered charity and a social landlord. Charities can have commercial subsidiaries. We've set up an organisation called Hillbury Homes, which is going to build homes for sale. And we've set up Bamboo Lettings, which is going to be able to do market renting. So we're actually looking at two other sectors of the housing market. Currently, we provide homes for people in need that need social homes on affordable rents, but we're going to be doing market rent, which will be commercial for profit, housing stock through Bamboo, and we'll be doing homes for sale, which again for profit in Hillbury Homes. The idea being from these is that the profits we get back will go back to the charity, gift aid profits back to Magenta Living, the charity, and they will be ring-fenced in a pot which will then be able to be used to be able to subsidise homes for affordable rent, because if there's no government subsidy, in the main, the last round of grant that we had to build affordable homes, grants were around about £20,000 to £25,000, so we would have to find £20,000 to £25,000 for each unit to subsidise to make it an affordable rent. We will use the profits from Hillbury Homes and Bamboo's lettings to fill that gap. So we're actually on with that. We're actually building some homes through Hillbury Homes to start with, and we're looking at doing a trial project for Bamboo Estates, where we're leasing some properties to them to let on market rents. So that's where we are with that group structure, and that's just starting to roll out. We've had to get our funders' approval, and we've had to get the regulators' approval to set these up, and we've just only this last week got those approvals to be able to do that. In terms of Clifton Avenue, we found the steady decline of that estate, again because larger flatted accommodation, some up to three bedroom flats, where it's been heavily affected by people on welfare benefits not being able to afford to take those. So we are looking at a scheme where we can actually rehouse people, clear the area and actually build a new build scheme on the site. Very early days yet, but I think we've got to the stage where we can't hold the properties together and let them. We've got a number of vacancies, so I think it's time that we develop that plan. Very happy to sit down with local board councils to talk you through those plans. First one, can you reconfigure some properties? We have looked at that, and the problem we've got in terms of turning a three-bedroom flat into a one and a two, it's just the cost is so prohibitive, it's very difficult. We looked at doing this with some houses as well, where we've got three-bedroom houses. We'd spend about £100,000 trying to sort of reconfigure. We'd never get that money back in income, so it really doesn't work, so we are looking at other things. Particularly one of the issues that we've got to look at is about maybe sharing accommodation, where it happens obviously in the student sector. If you're a professional going to live in London, you end up sharing houses. It doesn't tend to be the norm in this sector, but it's something we are looking at, about, you know, put three friends together, get a flat, a three-bedroom flat, and obviously they'd each get some benefit to pay the rent. So, as I say, it doesn't happen an awful lot, and some people that we have in chaotic lifestyles, there's a range of issues around that, but we are exploring those. But the conversions are very costly, and as I say, probably don't pay for themselves. The pensioners issue, yeah, you're quite right, that there are a number of issues there. One, if for medical grounds people have to have the two bedrooms, then we think they're going to be exempt, so we wouldn't be forcing people. And I think that is something that we have to sit down with the council and ourselves to think about. Particularly, the government plan is to give a ring-fence pot of money to the local authority to administer for those people affected by the local housing allowance in this area. How we can ensure that we can make sure that residents, as you described, are able to stay in their own homes, really, rather than force them to move. So that's something we look at, and clearly it might be something for our board to consider about, you know, do we need to put resources in that to ensure we've got stable communities? Because the alternative is we'll end up seeing some of our sheltered schemes ceasing to exist, and that wouldn't be the right thing. Your last question about working with health, we have worked with health, because we have got a couple of smaller schemes that we've done for adults with learning disabilities, which we work through with the Wirral and Cheshire Community Partnership to actually work with and identify those. And I know not just us, but other housing associations. I know Wirral Methodists have done a particular couple of schemes with particular vulnerable household groups that have been identified by health and mental health services that require more stable accommodation. So we are linked in. We're probably not as closely linked in to health. I think health is a whole different sort of organisational structure, and getting in the right place is difficult. It's not as close as maybe our links with housing and social services in the council, but we do have some of those links, but I think you're quite right, we could exploit them probably better.
Okay, it's going to be Joe and then Adam. you say, we won't shoot the messenger, it's not coming from you, we know where it's coming from. It's coming from the government. You know, that would be horrendous what's happening. How do we get around it? God knows. God knows. It is getting worse. I mean, when we look at, we're talking about homelessness next. I mean, why are we getting to, we're talking about we've got three-bedroom, two-bedroom properties that you can't let. You know, you're losing income. I mean, what does, if I've got a question, what's it costing in court fees just to take people to court?
Last year, it was £130,000.
Just in court fees?
Yeah. It's less this year.
Approach.
most affected is the Crossways estate in North Birkenhead. So I think there are some members here that know the estate. We have come up with a very targeted regeneration approach. So there is some selective demolition. We've got too much of one type of accommodation, one area. There is some remodelling there where we're actually taking these ones do lend themselves to some remodelling because they've got bathrooms downstairs in a very not very nice extension built in the 70s. We're bringing those up into the bedrooms, but we're giving people a choice. Some still want to have three bedrooms, others we're actually taking one of the bedrooms off to make the bathroom. We're also looking to have a homesteading scheme where we're encouraging people that may wish to buy a low cost home ownership scheme to change the demographics a little bit. I think in other areas, what we tend to be doing is looking and working harder with people to make sure that they are able to fully occupy and fully afford their premises. But as I say, we've got unpopularity, but with quite a lot of hard work on our staff, we can actually let the bulk that there are some hotspots, as I say, particularly North Birkenhead, where we've had major issues and we are looking at probably more difficult solutions to the problem.
It's Christina first. Christina?
Yeah, you mentioned before about three friends sharing. You actually told about multiple occupants of that. Yeah. So that's slightly different, isn't it? Disingenuous to say three friends. I guess a lot of people at my surgery who were having major problems with other people within the house, and I wondered what you will be doing if you go down that road to avoid that, especially when you've got mixed houses.
Yeah, you're quite right. As I say, it's an idea we're exploring, but the idea of this would be people that are known to each other or they're coming to us rather than actually putting, you know, the room next door we're letting to Fred Bloggs, who we don't know. The idea is to try and encourage units to come to us rather than just sort of putting three strangers together. As I say, it's very early days, but again, it's just another way of trying to deal with the accommodation situation we've got. But yeah, we're very mindful of houses and multiple occupation and there's a whole raft of regulatory issues there. But it's about how can we best use three-bedroom accommodation, particularly flatted accommodation, where there isn't other demand for it.
Thank you very much. You can relieve me.
Okay, we're going through to some people who spoke before now. I'd ask that you continue your excellent questions and maybe draw down your great speeches. Chris?
Just carrying off on what the conversation is, in my world, for instance, we have very few one or two bedroom accommodation that's available at all. So I think it's a bit unreasonable to ask people who lived in a certain area what they like, because they've got hit with the bedroom tax, which they've got this new way of getting their funding through, whatever, to actually upstick and move from somewhere like where they live or where they used to, lived all their life, grew up, move to the other side of the Wirral, where they've got one or two bedroom houses or they need to downsize to. So we really need to think about how we're going to manage that, because just to say it's a bit like a guy who should go on your bike and go for a jog down south, it doesn't work that way, because people will still be staying where they are.
Chris, so questions.
That was the question. How are we going to deal with that?
Well, as I said before, that's been part of the problem in terms of being able to assist people. We don't force people to go somewhere where they don't want to be. And clearly, there are issues, as Councillor Carubia has said, that in certain areas we have less types of accommodation. And as I said, generally, we've got mainly three-bed accommodation, certainly in terms of two-bed houses, it's very limited. In terms of flats, flat schemes tend to be in certain localities, so it is very difficult. And as I say, we don't force people, but if they want to remain, this is one of the areas where John will work with the residents and the council and see if a discretionary housing payment might cover it. But again, it's meant to be short-term, that. And there's no getting away from it, but as I said before, we are somehow governed by the demographics of Wirral, and the council has building programme.
way that they can afford to rent is to split the rent between friends, other tenants. And there are plenty of sites, you know, whose function is to sort of advertise people who are looking for, you know, a mutual person to rent a house with, aren't based on compatibility. I was just sort of wondering if that was something you could explore, you know, an online service which, you know, that brings people who are both your tenants and people looking to become your tenants and match them on some sort of compatibility, which of course will solve part of the veteran tax problem and also probably move people into the houses to rent properties and free up some of the easier to rent properties.
Yeah, as I say, it's an outline idea, and I think an online solution, because again, I think we are aware that younger people are more digitally literate and communicate more by digital means, and you know, that is the way of doing it. They don't go into estate agents, whatever, they look online. So something along those lines. I think the there will be a greater push for younger people to consider sharing, because the shared room rate comes in
2018.
In 2018, where there'll be a lesser level, if you're under 35, you'll be given a room rate, which I think is about £61, whereas obviously the average rent at the moment is about £90 or thereabouts. So clearly, with that rate, the younger people under 35 won't be able to get a property of their own, but they could share, and bringing it together. And that might be one way that we can actually push that out a bit further to attract people to this approach. But yeah, very good idea about an online facility which we'll look at.
Okay, planning Steve, very quick.
Yeah, I think the thing you did mention, Brian, from the team is that income is king in the business. And that not only are they able to deal with the uncertainty caused by welfare reform, but the government actually overnight imposed a 1% cut on rents, whereas it was linked to a predictable rate in the future, and so they have to deal with that at the same time. But my question and my plea is, when we talk about that group of people who say, well, we just manage, I think they're sort of people where other things fall off, because we've got all of the mass of authority behind us. I mean, you can chase them with the threat of eviction, ultimately. We can say, well, we're going to take you to court. So they're going to pay us because we've got the one fits. What else falls off their agenda? And often cases, it seems like food and access to other things. So I just want to plea against all the organisations that are here today, or the two organisations, that we are signposting people to the most effective way of help, whether it be food banks or other charities, that we are signposting to the best in the business as opposed to lots of different charities. I just hope that there's some coordination between the organisations of where we signpost people, because at the end of the day, we won't be able to help everyone, but we'll be the third sector that we'll be able to help when they're waiting for them at the universal credit, and or when they are behind because of you know, betting tax and so on, that we are getting the most for our book, or we're getting the best charities to help these people, and I hope that message goes across.
Worthy plea, we're not questioning, but we'll question it anyway. But before you do, if I tap onto that, you mentioned that the benefit cap may affect your ability or willingness to build kind of supported housing, because it's going to be more difficult to get those rents. Could you speak to whether we've got a coping strategy so these things are still built?
Okay, well, John picks up the first question, which is Councillor Foulkes, and I'll pick up Councillor Brightmore's.
Just explain what our financial inclusion team looks like. We've got three welfare benefits advisors, and we've got two full-time and one part-time financial inclusion advisors, we call that. So when someone approaches us, or through someone getting into interviews, they refer to the team triages, do they need welfare benefits advice, are they missing out on PIP or ESA or something, or is it more about budgeting or clearing the shortfall? We are attached to the food bank and Wirral. I was just looking at the numbers that we put through from when it started in, I think, January 2012. And the graph just goes gradually up month on month. We're
housing strategy is part of the Wirral 2020 plan and aligns with the strategies that sit under that. It's important just to remember that so that you have the context of where the housing strategy sits. So the second thing to say is this is not a standalone strategy. So although it deals with housing, it is interrelated with a whole range of other issues, some of which you've just seen in the last presentation tonight, whether it's to registered providers, whether it's the health sector, and so on. And the third thing to say about the strategy is whilst it's got very clear objectives and targets for 2020, it is a strategy that has flexibility within it, which enables it to actually adapt to the current circumstances we have, but the changing circumstances that we know that we're going to be faced with as well. So with those initial comments, I'll circulate a copy of this presentation to you afterwards. The strategy, as you may know, was approved in July of 2016. It seeks to provide good quality housing which meets the needs of Wirral residents. And we know that a safe and secure home is vital to all of Wirral's residents, wherever they may live across the borough, in whatever circumstances they may find themselves. And what we're seeking to do through this strategy is to improve the quality of the housing, the supply of the housing, and to ensure that it actually meets the needs of our residents, as you can see there on the slide. The strategy has three main objectives. The first is about building more homes in Wirral to meet our economic growth ambitions. They can quite clearly see the link between housing and economic growth. We want to improve the quality of Wirral's housing offer for all of our residents. And we also want to meet the needs of our most vulnerable people to enable them to live independently. So I think the key message coming through all of that, that although we have a housing strategy, it's not just about bricks and mortar, as I think Brian said in his presentation, but it's about people, it's about the residents of Wirral, both today and also tomorrow. We have a number of priorities that the strategy seeks to address. I'm not going to go through all of those because of the time, and you'll see these and be familiar with them in the strategy, and these are the pledges. But it's around building more homes by 2020. We need to improve the quality of the housing by addressing issues around the existing housing stock that we've got and also bringing empty properties back into use. And it's also meeting the needs and supporting those of our communities who are the most vulnerable. And that's looking at things like extra care, how we can prevent homelessness and the like. So that in very brief summary is the strategy and the key objectives of it. I just want to focus now for a few minutes on some of the achievements of the strategy to date and what's actually going well. So, in terms of where we are, we've built just over 700 new homes so far, this year since the strategy came in. And 385 of those are affordable homes, which I think is quite an important consideration. We need to do more, but we're moving forward significantly. We've got over 500 empty properties back into use to date, which again is important using the existing housing stock that we have. We're doing quite a lot of work with the private sector homes that we have in Wirral. A lot of work there to actually remove hazards and improve the conditions within those properties. And we've got a very active programme of adaptations for existing properties which help people to benefit from those vulnerable people, people with disabilities and the like. And a key part of the strategy is also not just about tackling the issues that come up, but it's preventing those issues before they actually arise. And prevention is often better than the cure, and we put quite a lot of time and effort into doing that. We're also very actively at the moment, with the Liverpool City Region and from Wirral's point of view as well, bidding into government funding programmes to help to take forward the housing agenda. So you may have heard just recently that there's been a very successful successful starter homes bid that the Liverpool City Region has gained, and we're beginning to look at the details of that at the moment. Just securing over £7 million for Wirral to provide a minimum number of 280 more affordable homes, and that's in partnership with the registered providers. Our income from the selected licensing scheme is actually greater than we first forecast because of the higher number of private rented sectors in those areas, and that gives us an opportunity to use that resource. At the end of last year, we made a successful bid to DCLG, contributing to the local government, for a housing zone status for Wirral. And the housing zone in Wirral covers Wirral Waters, parts of Morden, parts of Rock Ferry, and parts of Bromford. And the significance of the housing zone is it's like a key that unlocks the door. So when you have that status, it enables you to bid for other government funding that becomes available. So again, just before Christmas, we put in a funding bid of close on £1 million to actually get additional resources to help to support the delivery of the housing agenda in Wirral. And we're expecting some decisions on that bid later this month. Housing links with many other services, and we do a lot of networking and partnership working with people like the registered providers, with our adult social services colleagues and others, to enable us to actually address the housing issues in a coordinated way. Because it's often the issues that people have are not just about housing, but about other things as well. And we're trying to get a whole approach to addressing those issues. So those are some of the achievements that we've achieved to date. We have a long way to go on some of those things, but I think we are making progress. But the environment in which we are operating is very challenging, as you will be aware from the last presentation, obviously through your own experience. Just to highlight a number of those things for you. The first is around the demographic changes that we've seen. So the number of older people, for example, in Wirral is going to grow over the next few years. People are living longer, which on one side of things is very good, but on the other side, health needs become more complex. And the accommodation that people need to live with some of those conditions becomes more specialist. And therefore, when you look at things like extra care provision, when you might need to look at some of these concepts around sort of the care villages, where you can have a progressive support for increasing health issues, but those types of concepts and issues are something that we'll look at. Welfare reform change, I won't say more on that because you've just had a long and good discussion about that. We've got some other issues that are coming through around private rented sector selective licensing, some challenges there around actually managing that because of the increased number of private rented properties that we're seeing and experiencing, and that is something that we need to look at. There's still quite high demand from yourselves as elected members, quite likely, and also local residents, about where there are poor standards within the private sector and how we can actually address those within the housing market. And there's a number of policy changes coming out of government on a fairly regular basis around things like housing and multiple occupation, the homelessness bill, which we'll come on to talk about in the next item on the agenda tonight, and others that will begin to emerge. Within that context of challenges, we think there are a number of significant opportunities that we can also look at. So what we've just done in the last couple of weeks is we've reformed the Strategic Housing Partnership with all of the registered providers represented on that. And that is really important because it helps to pick up a number of the issues that you were raising earlier about are we coordinated on addressing the housing issues across later this week because the registered providers have just been awarded their grants through the Homes and Communities Agency, and there's a considerable sum of money to invest in providing new housing in Wirral. So we'll be having some meetings with them to look at how we can support the registered providers to identify appropriate sites. Often they compete with each other because of the way the funding is organised. What we're trying to do is say to them that we need to work together to use those resources to provide the housing that is needed in Wirral on the sites where that is appropriate. And then we'll go one step further, and rather than just say, well, there's a site, move things through your housing processes or through the planning processes, we will work closely with those registered providers to help them move through those processes. So the planning system is aligned with the housing needs and requirements, and it was successful with the bid that we're expecting out of government later this month. That will give us some additional resources to actually deliver on some of these sites and provide some resources to enable us to actually do that and support it. So it's really key and important that we do that. Not only will that apply to the registered providers, but it will also apply to the private sector house builders. And again, we will work with them to facilitate development. What we have in Wirral is a number of extended planning permissions, but nothing is happening on the sites. What we need to ensure, and we will go through each of those approved planning permissions, and we'll be speaking to the owners, and we'll be working proactively to bring those sites forward for development, using the existing assets and resources that we've got to maximum effect. The implementation of the housing zone is something that we're actively working on now. So we have a pipeline of projects, we have some resources coming in that are actually going to help to drive those developments and make them happen. Again, just providing the housing that we need. We're also beginning to look at an opportunity that may exist to do what's called direct commissioning, which means that local authorities or local authorities working with other partners may have an opportunity to go back and directly build houses. Now, that's very early days, it needs a lot of work on it to explore whether that is an opportunity for us. But what I'm illustrating is that we're looking at all of the opportunities that they are to address and deliver the housing strategy. There are some opportunities, we think, to look at extending the selective licensing areas that we have in Wirral. Clearly, there will be implications of doing that, but one of the positive benefits of it, as we've begun to see already in the areas that do benefit from selective licensing, is that it does help